told you about those Christians. It's just a tactic that Satan uses. He comes after those of us who try to live this Christian lifestyle. Even God's Word, 2 Timothy, says, if you seek to live a godly life, you will be. Not you could be, might be, should be. You will be persecuted. Pray for the people that consider themselves to be Christian. But anyway, when I met this man who used to be an ex-pastor, he wasn't living any kind of godly lifestyle at all. Neither was I. We rode home and back and forth to work together. The ride home, we always have a couple of drinks. In fact, if I'm real honest with you, we have a lot of drinks. We have a lot of drinks before we left, and a lot of drinks on the way home. And somehow, the conversation would always turn to God and the things of God. See, I believe it doesn't matter where you're at. I don't believe it matters where you're at. God is right there with you. And he's calling you to himself, just as he did Paul. He met him on a road where he was about to go and murder people. So in case you fall asleep, in case you get distracted, in case you have to leave early, I'm going to tell you the big idea of today's message right up front. God will follow you no matter where you are to get him to follow, or get you to follow him. God will follow you no matter where you're at to get you to follow him. This man, this former preacher, he would tell me the things that took place in his ministry, and there are things that I can hardly imagine, let alone wrap my head around. I mean, he told me stories of exorcisms he performed. He told me the story of the voices that would come out of these people's mouth that wasn't their voice. He told me things like you see on TV. He told me things like that you see on the movie or see on TV or see all in the, if you ever saw the movie The Exorcist. He told me one time he walked into a room, and when he walked into the room, the lamps and the tables were actually flying around the room. Now, I'm going to tell you, I know all this sounds unbelievable, but I can tell you this. He told me in such a way that I know at least he believed what was going on. I mean, I've never seen any of those things. I don't pretend to tell you I've ever seen anything. But when he told these stories, he told them with such conviction, he at least believed they took place. This man saw the power of God in ways most of us will never have an opportunity to do. He saw what God was doing through him. He saw what was God doing through his church. And he knew God had a purpose and a plan for his life. And he's married to a girl. Now, I call her a girl because she was many years younger than him. They were ministering together. Miracles were taking place. I can't even begin to express you the number of things that he considered to be a miracle that took place in his life during this period of time. I mean, God was good and life was good. One day he comes home and his wife said, you know, do you think it would be okay if we had a glass of wine with dinner? Well, he knew Scripture. There's nothing wrong with having a glass of wine. What the Bible says wrong is wrong. So they went out, bought a bottle of wine, and they had a glass of wine with dinner. But he said, soon this became the norm. You know, he'd get off from his ministry, she'd get off from their ministry, they'd come home, they'd have dinner, they'd have a glass of dinner, and they're probably at home almost every night. Then they would start having a glass of wine or a beer when they went out to dinner. Next thing you know, they'll go out to dinner and they have a bite to eat. And before the food came, they have a glass of beer or a glass of wine and then they'll order another one. Now, he didn't tell me this, but I can almost promise you this. He didn't go to a restaurant in town. He was a pastor. He went out of town. And like I said, his wife's much younger than he is. And she's decided now that she's missing out on some things that her friends are having. And she comes to her husband once again and says, you think it's okay maybe if we're going to dance tonight? Not wanting to upset this young wife, who I know he truly loved. In fact, I believe she was the love of his life. He's been married many times, but I think this is the one that he really loved. He said, sure. So he said they began to go out to nightclubs and dance and have a couple of drinks at the nightclub. And I think you can already see where we're headed, right? Yeah. And he told me before you knew it, we were caught up in this lifestyle. His wife, this woman he loved, this woman he cherished, this woman he would do almost anything for, began to have an affair. And they separated. He left the ministry. Now try to put this picture before your mind. Here are two Christian people. Two people who have been anointed by God. A Christian couple who were doing great work for God. Doing great work for God's kingdom. And they're seeing the work that they're doing being glorified by God. They're feeling the power of God. God working through them. And what feels like all of a sudden, but in reality, through time, they find themselves in a place they never thought they would be. His wife is in the bed of another man. He's had enough daughters to bed. He's alone, he's in his home, and he's contemplating suicide. He's so depressed he can't even do anything but think about how to end his own life. Two children of God. Two anointed Christians in a place that they could have never imagined themselves to be. You have to ask yourself, to be honest, have you ever been? Maybe not an adulterous affair, okay? Maybe you're looking at some things on TV or on the internet that you know you ought not be looking at. Maybe it's some kind of a hidden addiction to alcohol or to drugs, even prescription drugs. Maybe you're at the slots or the poker table playing with money that you know you don't really have. Maybe you're flirting with the girl at the office or the man behind the counter at the local store and you're thinking to yourself, this could go a lot harder if I really wanted to. Something that you know is wrong, especially wrong for a child of God. If that's you, or if that's somebody you know, I'm praying that God will reveal His goodness, that God will reveal His grace, that God will reveal His mercy, that God will reveal His love in this story of this dagger for which you've been. So I'm asking, if you will, if you have your Bibles this morning, I'm going to read the entire chapter, 1 Samuel 28. And I'm going to ask God through the power of the Holy Spirit to show us Jesus Christ and what He has to say to us and how we can apply it to our lives. But this is a chapter that deals heavily with the occult. So I'm going to ask us to bow and pray for God's protection, for the Holy Spirit to give us, and for the Holy Spirit to give us the true meaning of what He wants us to know. Heavenly Father, we just come to You today and we pray and we thank You, Lord. We thank You for the offer of salvation we have through Jesus Christ. And we thank You, Lord, that You'll follow us into the lowest places. Father, that You love us so much, no matter what we've done, no matter what we have, no matter what we got, no matter what we're doing, that You will follow us and just call us continually so that we'll repent, so that we'll change our way of thinking, so that we'll change our way of acting, come to You. Father, this story speaks of a lot of things that You have forbidden. It speaks of evil spirits, and we ask that You put Your protection upon us today, Lord. Lord, these things are difficult to speak about, but we know that they're real. I know that they're real. I've seen some things in my life. So, Lord, I'm asking for Your protection upon everybody here today and everybody who ever hears this message. Amen. Okay, so I'm going to begin by reading the scriptures, and you can follow along in the Bible, or you can follow along on the screen, and we'll go from there. 1 Samuel chapter 28, beginning in verse 1. About that time, the Philistines mustered their armies for another war with Israel. King Achish told David, "You and your men will be expected to join me in battle." "Very well," David agreed. "Now you will see for yourself what we can do." Then Achish told David, "I will make you my personal bodyguard for life." Meanwhile, Samuel had died, and all of Israel had mourned for him. He was buried at Ramah, his hometown. And Saul had banned from the land of Israel all mediums and those who consult the spirits of the dead. The Philistines set up their camp at Shunem, and Saul gathered all the army of Israel and camped at Gilboa. When Saul saw the vast Philistine army, he became frantic with fear. He asked the Lord what he should do, but the Lord refused to answer him, either by dreams or by sacred lots or by prophets. Saul then said to his advisor, "Find me a woman who is a medium so I can go and ask her what to do." His advisors replied, There is a medium at Endor. Saul disguised himself by wearing ordinary clothing instead of his royal robes. Then he went to the woman's home at night, accompanied by two of his men. I have to talk to a man who has died, he said. Will you call up this spirit for me? Were you trying to get me killed, the woman demanded? You know that Saul has outlawed all the mediums and all that who consult the spirits of the dead. Why are you setting a trap for me? But Saul took an oath in the name of the Lord and promised, as surely as the Lord lives, nothing bad will happen to you for doing this. Finally, the woman said, well, whose spirit do you want me to call up? Call up Samuel, Saul replied. When the woman saw Samuel, she screamed, you have deceived me, you are Saul. Don't be afraid, the king told her. What do you see? I see a God coming up out of the earth, she said. What does he look like? Saul asked. He's an old man wrapped in a robe, she replied. Saul realized it was Samuel, and he fell to the ground before him. Why have you disturbed me by calling me back? Samuel asked Saul. Because I'm in deep trouble, Saul replied. The Philistines are at war with me, and God has left me and won't reply by prophets or dreams, but I've called for you to tell me what to do. But Samuel replied, why ask me, since the Lord has left you and has become your enemy? The Lord has done just as he said he would. He has torn the kingdom from you and given it to your rival, David. The Lord has done this to you today because you refused to carry out his fierce anger against the Amalekites. What's more, the Lord will hand you and the army of Israel over to the Philistines tomorrow. You and your sons will be here with me. The Lord will bring down the entire army of Israel in defeat. Saul fell full length on the ground, paralyzed with fright because of Samuel's word. He was also faint with hunger, for he had eaten nothing all day and all night. When the woman saw how distraught he was, she said, sir, I have obeyed your command at the risk of my own life. Now do what I say, and let me give you a little something to eat so you can regain your strength for the trip back. But Paul refused to eat anything. Then his advisors joined the woman in urging him to eat. So he finally yielded and got up from the ground and sat on the couch. The woman had been fattening a calf, so she hurried out and killed it. She took some flour, kneaded it into dough, and baked unleavened bread. She brought the meal to Saul and his advisors, and they ate it. Then they went out. May God reveal to us what his word has to say, and the illustration of the picture he wants us to see. See, now, as I start this, as I begin to study this, there's a lot of questions we can ask ourselves about this scripture, about this section of scripture. And sometimes, if we do all that, we miss the point of what God's trying to say to us. And I think that's one of the reasons why so many pastors stay away from this chapter. I mean, for example, was it really Samuel who was called up from the dead? Was this some kind of illusion? Was it the medium who did it? Was it the devil who did it? Or did God do it? I mean, would God really use something that he has condemned and called an abomination? Would God use magical arts to bring up a dead prophet? And why did Samuel look like an old man? I mean, do we stay the same age we are when we die? Oh, God, I'm just telling you. Why is he in a robe and not in a glorified body? What did he mean when he said Saul and his sons would join him the next day? Was that just in death? Or is it those that are saved and departed? See, there's a lot of questions we can ask ourselves, and we'll miss the point of what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell us and trying to teach us. So as I begin to look at this scripture, as I begin to study it, you know, I knew God didn't put it in his word just to give us information. It's not for a history lesson. But God wants us to have transformation so that we can have salvation. So what does the Holy Spirit want us to know, and how does he want to instruct us so that we can see Jesus Christ through this story of a witch bringing up a dead prophet and a king who is anointed or was anointed by God? So when you come to a passage like this, and you want to know how God is revealed in it, the first thing you have to do is start with what you know is 100% true. That's where you always start, okay? So as we open up this story, what the first thing we find is two men of God, two men that God has anointed with his Holy Spirit, and we find them in places they shouldn't be. Chapter 28 starts out like this. About that time, the Philistines mustered their armies for another war with Israel. King Achish told David, "You and your men will be expected to join me in battle. Very well, David agreed. "Now you will see for yourself what we can do." And Achish told David, "I will make you my bodyguard for life." Now, we read that, and the first thing I want you to know is that the focus of this is not David. We're not going to spend a lot of time on David, but I want you to see that David is in a place that he shouldn't be. The prophet Samuel, before he died, had told David he would become the king of all of Israel. But where do we find David? The future king of Israel is in the Philistine army. And you might not realize the significance of that, but the Philistines were the arch enemies of Israel. Here is the future king of Israel about to fight Israel. Here's the future king of Israel about to fight the people that he is supposed to lead. He's about to go in. He's told Achish, the king of the Philistines, "Watch what we can do. Watch how many people we can beat. Watch how many people we can kill." This is the people that he's supposed to be the king of. He's getting ready to do all this to. But even here, we begin to see God's grace and God's mercy and God's love. Because if you read into chapter 29, you'll see that God miraculously keeps David from doing the thing that he was about to do. And when I saw that, I thought to myself, I wonder how many times God has kept me from doing the thing I was about to do that I knew was wrong. I had justified it, but it wasn't just. Very beginning, here in this story, David's in the wrong place. He's about to do a terrible thing. But we see God is so filled with love and mercy and grace that he protects David from doing the very thing he's about to do. Now, again, sometimes the problem is our adversary, Satan, likes to have us focus on something other than what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell us. And when he does this, we miss God's goodness. If you just preach this on the evils of the sorcery or evil of witches or the evils of the occult, you miss God's goodness in this story. This is an account of God's love. I hope I can let you see that today through the power of the Holy Spirit. This is a story, an account of God's grace and his wonderful mercy. It's not just an account of a witch and the occult. But what do we know about Saul? What can we be certain of? Well, first of all, there's no question about the fact that Saul was a child of God. I mean, we know Saul was anointed by God through the prophet Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 9 tells us this, and in the interest of time, I'm not going to go into detail on that right now. I'd let you read that for yourself. We know the Spirit of God was on Saul. The Spirit of God often came upon Saul. We know Saul had very humble beginnings. In fact, when the prophet Samuel told him he was anointed by God to become the first king of Israel, in 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 21, Saul says, Am I not a Benjamite? I am of the smallest tribe of all of Israel. And my family, not only am I of the smallest tribe, my family is the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin. Why do you speak like this to me? At this point in time in his life, Saul was a humble man. There was a day when Saul's heart was right. To put this in modern church language, Saul was saved. He was saved. But you look at him now. Look at him in the story. We find him in the... He's full of anger. He's become legalistic. He's become jealous over David. He's put his family, he's put his kingdom in bondage. He's become an all-absorbing passion just to kill David. He's become formal in his worship. He's become realistic, ritualistic in his relationship with God. His worship has become mechanical. At this point in history, he's been chasing and trying to kill David for 12 years. Now, it's hard to believe that a child of God, one who is anointed by God, could have gotten to a place like this. Now, there's two views on salvation, and I want to sort of make this clear because it adds and helps understand what's going on. One is called the Calvinistic view, or once saved, always saved. And for those of you that are that view, you would say that Saul was never truly saved. And I find this very unlikely, considering the number of times the scriptures tell us that Saul was anointed by God. Other view is called the Arminian view. Some people know it as the Wesleyan view. And this view says you can walk away from God and his offer of salvation. That you have the free will to come to God, and even if you come to him, you have the free will to walk away. And then if this is your view, you would say something like, well, Saul was saved, but he had the free will to walk away from his salvation, and he did this. Now, this is the view I personally take, but theologians have been fighting over for years. And I don't know how it all works together. The scripture says the Holy Spirit brings us into Christ, and the Holy Spirit gives us the free will to choose Christ. So how it all works together, I think both views are true, and how they work together, I don't know. And people have been fighting for it over the years. I never quite understood why. I remember old Saint God in one of the churches I was going to, he's now in glory, he's passed away, but he stood up in a service and he said, I'm going to err on the side of God. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I don't understand his churches and denominations why we got to disagree, because one thing they both agree on, and that is there is a necessary response, there is a necessary action to salvation. And I don't know how it all works together, but I'm not going to take any chances. I'm going to err on the side of God when it comes to eternity and heaven and hell. And verse 3 says, meanwhile, Samuel had died and Israel had mourned for him. He was buried in Ramah, his hometown. And Saul had banned from the land all mediums and those who consult the spirits of the dead. Wait, Saul, you're just looking for a medium. Didn't you just, you banned them from the country? There's no mediums here. You can't be impressed with that. Because you're going to see in a few verses, even though Samuel had removed the witchcraft from the land, he never removed the witchcraft from his heart. Lesson number one is this. We can make a great show of denouncing sin and condemning sin publicly, but if our heart is not changed, our sin will return, just like it did in my friend, the ex-pastor. Just knowing what's right and wrong, just knowing what's right and condemning what's wrong, doesn't take the place of doing what is right. And I think that's one of the problems we have in the churches today. We're saying it's okay if you do this, and God's Word says it isn't. So sometimes you get that feel-good message, sometimes you get that message that steps on your toes. At the end of the day, you get to choose which one this is. Lesson number one is, we can condemn sin publicly. If our heart is not changed, if there's no transformation in us, that sin is going to return. We should let life's difficulties, we should let life's obstacles push us in God's direction. We should let those things make us depend on Him, because when we turn to anything or anyone else, it's going to lead to disaster. And God's going to give a picture of that to us very soon. says the Philistines were set up camp at Shunem, and Saul gathered all the army of Israel and camped at Gilboa. If you were looking at a map, what you'd find is that Shunem and Gilboa are only about 4 or 5 miles apart. Now, when you bring thousands of people together and there's only 4 or 5 miles apart, you're close enough that you can see each other's army. And when Saul saw the vast Philistine army, he became frantic with fear. Lesson number two is this. This is important. This is important, so please listen. When you're scared and you're afraid, you are capable of becoming involved in all kinds of sin. You are capable of doing things that you never dreamed you were capable of. Saul allowed his fear to get him to make foolish and wicked choices. When you're scared and you're afraid, you'll do things, you'll turn to things, you'll turn to people you never even thought or believed you'd be able to turn to. In desperation, you do not know what you're capable of. And we really, really, really have to pay attention to what God's Word says. As he asked the Lord what he should do, the Lord refused to answer him, either by dreams or by sacred laws or the prophets. There are no words from God. There are no words from the prophets. There are no words from the priests. No words in dreams. No words in visions. Everything is gone. God is sovereign. And when I first read this, maybe you had the same thought that I had. Why, no wonder God isn't talking to Saul. Look where he's at. Look at the sin he's in. Now it's true, when God seems quiet, it might be that sin is blocking the way. That might be true, but in this particular case, it goes so much deeper than that. Verse 6 says, when he asked the Lord what he should do, but the Lord refused to answer him. Now, if you're a Bible scholar, I know this message is a little bit deeper, a little bit more teaching than you can get on Sunday mornings. But if you're a Bible scholar, you may know what it says in 1 Chronicles chapter 10, verses 13 and 14. And this is what you find in 1 Chronicles. So Saul died. We know he died the next day and died. He died because he was unfaithful to the Lord. He failed to obey the Lord's command. And he even consulted a medium instead of asking the Lord for guidance. He consulted a medium instead of asking the Lord for guidance. Hold on to that thought. So the Lord killed him and turned the kingdom over to David, the son of Jesse. Now, 1 Chronicles says Saul didn't ask the Lord, didn't inquire of the Lord for guidance, right? And 1 Samuel, we know, says that Saul did ask the Lord. So you look at this and say, well, did he ask the Lord or didn't he ask the Lord? What's the contradiction? Is there a contradiction here? It seems to contradict 1 Samuel that says Saul asked of the Lord and the Lord refused to answer. And 1 Chronicles says he didn't ask the Lord. So again, we start with what we know is 100% true. We know there's no contradiction because this is Scripture, this is the Holy Bible, and there's no contradiction in Scripture. There's no contradiction in the Bible. If it appears to be a contradiction, it's in our mind and not in the Bible. Some things that appear in Scripture are very difficult to explain. Some of the things that appear to contradict are not easily answered. But fortunately for us, that's not the case when it comes here. What happens, as so often is the case, is the translation is lost when we translate from Hebrew, or from Hebrew in this case, or Greek in the New Testament, or Aramaic, is it's lost in the translation. The Hebrew word that is used for 1 Samuel in 28 verse 6, the word we translated ask in the New Living Translation, or inquire in some of the other different translations, is from a Hebrew word that's different than the one that's used in 1 Chronicles. The word used in 1 Samuel 28:6, and if you're a Hebrew scholar, forgive me if I mispronounce it, I think I'm pronouncing it correctly, it's called shoel. Now, shoel at its very root means this. It means by extension, to demand, to ask counsel of, to wish. The word that's used in First Chronicles is Darash. And that word means to ask or to seek. To ask or to seek specifically for worship. So see, Saul doesn't come to God really inquiring or really asking, but he's wishing, he's begging, he's demanding from the Lord to give him an answer. He comes demanding, but he's not worshiping. You know, so there's a little lesson in there too. If you don't come to God with the right attitude, you might as well not come to him at all. Now here's what's interesting. In 1 Samuel 28:7, Saul then said to his advisors, find a woman who is a medium so I can go and ask her what to do. Guess which word the Holy Spirit uses when Saul wants to ask of or inquire of the medium? If you said the rag, you would be correct. Saul's coming to the medium in sincerity. He's actually coming to the medium in a form of worship. But that's not how he came to God. See, when you're scared, and when you're afraid, and you're desperate, you may ask of the Lord, you may inquire of the Lord, but if he doesn't answer you in a very short period of time, or he doesn't answer you the way you think he should, you're going to be tempted to look for things and look for answers in places and from people you've never been to even look for. Find me a woman who is a medium so I can go and ask her what to do. But there's a medium, there's a witch, there's a spiritist in him. So Saul disguises himself by wearing ordinary clothing instead of royal robes. And he went to the woman's house at night accompanied by two of his men. I have to talk to a man who's dead. Will you call up his spirit? And I look at this and I say, it is hard for me to believe that a child of God could end up like this. In desperation, Saul, this child of God, ends up in such a low place. He ends up at the house of the witch. But look at this, he's not there by himself, is he? See, one of the things that we find out is when we step out into sin, we bring others along with us too. And guess who we usually bring? The people we love the most. The people we trust the most. Saul takes his most trusted advisor and brings him right into sin. See, here's what I believe. This is what I believe this story picture. This is a picture. The Holy Spirit has given us a picture of a Christian that's in a low place. I mean, there is no words from God. There are no words from the prophet. There are no words from the priest. There are no dreams. There are no visions. Everything is gone and God is silent. Saul, this child of God, is in a place that God has condemned and called an abomination. And we look at this and we say, what in the world is a Christian doing at a witch's house? How does he or she end up in a place that God has condemned? How did they become so hard? How did they become so callous? See, I think the Holy Spirit has given us a picture of a Christian that's at the bottom. And not just at the bottom, but at the bottom of the bottom. They are way, way down. They have to jump up to get to the bottom. And I hope, and I pray, this is not an illustration of anybody that's in here today. But I can tell you, because of what this story represents to me, I am so glad God included it in our lives. It's a precious teaching. It shows us God's grace and God's mercy and God's love in such a special way. Saul is at the bottom as a rebellious, a wayward child of God. He's at a witch's house. Saul, what are you doing at the witch's house? But you know, there could be a million applications to this. Christian, what are you doing in the harlot's bed? Christian, what are you doing in an adulterous affair? Christian,
liquor store.
Christian, what are you doing in divorce court? Christian, why are you sitting there drunk in your chair in front of the TV? Christian, what are you doing in premarital sex? Christian, what are you doing looking at pornography on the internet? Christian, why are you embezzling money? Christian, why are you in prison? Christian, what are you doing at the witch's house? So many applications. Is it possible for a Christian to get that love? Is it possible for a Christian to succumb to supervision, to perversion, to get to a place where he or she is in a place that God calls an abomination, where he or she is holding hands with the transgressions, with those things that God has condemned, where they're even numbered with the transgressions? Because I'm here to tell you, you bet they can. We see it on the news and in the papers and the rumors all the time. And look at how Saul goes. He goes in disguise. So let me tell you a couple things. Christians don't walk in the liquor store and go, praise God, I'm on the way to heaven, but before I go, I want a 12-pack and a buzz. Christians don't walk in the bar looking to have an adulterous affair and say, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior, but can you come over here? They don't say, I've been saved by the blood of Jesus, and then hold hands with the transgressors. Christians involved in the low, low places that God has condemned, they operate in the dark, they operate in secret, they operate in disguise. They hide who they are. They try to make themselves look like the people they're dealing with. They put on masks, and they hide in the dark. They're hiding from the light, hiding from God, because darkness and disobedience go together. When a Christian gets that love, when they get into those situations, what can they expect from God? How does God respond? And again, I speak as a fool. And if I was God, I would have shut the door on Saul a long, long time ago. When you read the whole story of Saul, when you know his life, you find out that Saul disobeyed God time and time and time again. He became the high priest after God had specifically told him not to do that. He carried the spoils of war home because of the covetous in his heart when he knew he wasn't supposed to do that. He tried to kill the man that God had chosen. He knew God had chosen to replace him. A man after his own, after God's own heart, a man by the name of David. He even rose up against his own son, Jonathan. He destroyed God's priest. I mean, when you look at all that Saul done, if I was God and I speak as a fool, I would have been done with Saul a long time ago. Saul, that's it. I can't take it anymore. I give up on you. That's it. You're done. Aren't you glad God didn't give up on you? Aren't you glad God didn't give up on Saul? Verse 19 says, are you trying to get me killed? The woman demanded, you know Saul has outlined all the mediums and all the assault the spirits of the dead. Why are you setting a trap for me? Never mind the fact that she's talking to dead people. Never mind the fact that she's breaking God's law. All this bad girl cares about is she might get caught breaking the law of the Lord. I understand. I've done it. Lord, please don't let me get caught. I know I'm not supposed to be doing this, okay? I know this is sin and you don't like it. Please don't let me get caught doing it. All she cares about is not breaking laws. She doesn't have her heart belonging to God. And look what Saul does. This is so amazing. When you read God's word, we just read it blah, blah, blah sometimes. Saul responds by swearing by the Lord, he no longer trusts or obeys. Sadly, 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 this is the last time that's ever recorded that Saul even utters the name of the Lord. But Saul took an oath in the name of the Lord, but I'm trusting and obey, but I'm still going to tell her I'm going to swear by you, okay? Surely as the Lord lives, nothing would happen to you regardless. Saul no longer knows right from wrong. Here's the third lesson. Here's the third lesson we learn when we become desperate. We start looking for answers in the wrong place. When we end up where we don't belong, we confuse right and wrong. Fear and desperation can cause us to confuse right and wrong. We compromise what we believe. We compromise what we know. We think we know better than the Lord does, and eventually we'll find ourselves just where Saul is, where we are dishonoring God and we're seeking help in ungodly places. Finally, the woman said, "For whose spirit do you want me to call up?" "Call up Samuel," Saul replied. Now, again, you may not know this story, you may not know the story of Saul, but if you know the story of Saul, you would think Samuel would be the last person Saul would ever want to be called up. While he lived, Samuel rarely had any good news for Saul at all. And you really think that death is going to improve that situation? And what about the meeting? What about the witch? I mean, wouldn't you think that she'd be nervous? I mean, even when you're in sin, you know you're in sin. Don't you think she'd be at least nervous about calling up a prophet of the Lord? Here's my personal belief. I think she's like the fortune tellers of the day. Sure, I'll call her up. But she didn't expect nobody to come up. You know, sure, I'll do it. I've got smoky mirrors here. I'll pretend like I'm doing this. But in the next verse, we see the outcome of her efforts. But here's the amazing thing. We don't see how she did it. See, sometimes we know the wisdom of God by what he puts. Exactly. Sometimes we know the wisdom of God by what he puts in the scriptures, and sometimes we know the wisdom of God by what he leaves out. Right? God knows our hard hearts. God knows that we're stiff-necked. God knows if we knew the secret recipe of pulling up dead people, we'd probably try it. So he doesn't put it in there. When the woman saw Sam, what'd she do? She screamed! You know, if it was me, I think it'd be the customers that scream. I mean, she does this for a living. She sees people all the time, right? She shouldn't have screamed. I think she was just as surprised as everybody else when Samuel rose up. And we don't know how she knew for sure when she saw Samuel that she recognized Saul as well. But you talk about being between a rock and a hard place. I mean, you got a dead prophet on one side, and you got a scared, desperate king on the other. There's nowhere to turn for her. King says, "Don't be afraid. What do you see?" Listen to this word. "I see a God coming up out of the earth," she said. Saul must not have been able to see anything at all, but he obviously believed her because he says, "Describe what you see." In verse 14, what does he look like? So the witch, this medium, she begins to describe what she sees. "He's an old man wrapped in a robe," she replies. Some translations say now. Now means robe. And Saul knew who it was. Saul realized it was Samuel, and he fell on the ground before him. Again, when you know the whole story, you find out how strange this really is, because it had been a long time since Saul had ever honored Samuel. And I don't think Samuel was too happy about being raised from the dead. "Why have you disturbed me by calling me back?" Samuel asked Saul. "Because I'm in deep trouble," Saul replied. "The Philistines have warned me. God has left me. He won't reply by prophets or dreams. So I had to call you to tell me what to do." And again, at this point, we stop and we ask some questions, some important questions. Like, who conjured up the spirit? Who's doing the talking here? Did the Lord conjure up Samuel? Was it the devil? Was it the medium? Was it the witch of Endor? Is it really Samuel who's talking? Could it have been God who conjured up the spirit of Samuel? I mean, sometimes you hate it when the answers aren't clear. So how do we discern the voice of God? How do we know the voice of God from the adversaries. And I'm going to give you three questions you can ask. They might help you discern and know God's voice. The first question is, what is the message? You go ahead and change the slide, I'm sorry. What is the message? What is the outcome? And who gets the glory? So we can do the same thing. This message is consistent with God's word, and it's consistent with Samuel's previous prophecies. But Samuel replied, why ask me, since the Lord has left you and become your enemy? The Lord has done just as he said he would. He has torn the kingdom from you and given it to your rival David. The Lord has done it to you today because you refused to carry out his fierce anger against the Amalekites. What's more, the Lord will hand you and the army of Israel over to the Philistines tomorrow, and you and your sons will be here with me. The Lord will bring down the entire army of Israel in defeat. What is the message? It's the prophecy has come to pass. The message is true. It's a true message. It's a true prophecy. It's not a false prophecy. Saul proclaimed the same messages from death that he did when he was alive. And the Lord fulfilled what the prophet has said. The second thing is, what is the outcome? Well, first of all, Saul was humbled on the spot. Saul realized it was Samuel, and he fell to the ground. And then we find out in chapter 9, not only was Saul humbled on the spot, he was humbled on the battlefield the very next day. The answer to the third question, who gets the glory? In this particular case, we know it's God alone. In this short speech from Samuel, he mentions the name of the Lord 7 times, the number which is used in the scriptures for perfection or completion. It's God who brings up the spirit of Samuel. And if it is Samuel, we have to ask, why choose God? Why would God do this? Why not put this story in another chapter of the Bible where it might be less confusing? Why use it now? Why use it here? Why use Samuel? And I think what you're going to find out is, God, even though he brought it up, Samuel's a picture of something much greater. And I know we're running a little long today, and I apologize for that. God wants to give us this great message. This Holy Spirit wants to instruct us. But why do it here? Why do it now? Why use a witch? And why use Saul? And why use Samuel? Again, we have to start with what we know is true. I think, and I hope I've shown you by now, that I believe Saul represents a fallen Christian. But let's look at what Samuel represents. And I'm going to tell you right up front that I've never seen this in a commentary. I've never heard it in another message. I've never read it in a book. So if you don't agree with me, it's very well that you could be in good company. This is what we know about Samuel. Samuel was the very last judge of Israel. Samuel was a judge, and he was the last judge of Israel. We know that he anointed Saul by the power of the Holy Spirit to be king over all Israel. He was a judge. The judge was the leading authority. He was the last judge of Israel. We also know, and the scripture makes it very clear, calls in this several times, that Samuel was a prophet. So first of all, Samuel was a judge. Samuel was a prophet. Let's look at one other thing. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 18, it says, "But Samuel, though he was only a boy, served the Lord. He wore the linen garments of a priest." Okay? So, he is a judge, prophet, and he's a priest. Now, who else in the Bible can you think of that is the last judge who walked here, is a prophet, wore the garments, and I might add, still wears the garments of a high priest, and who was resurrected to God from the dead? Wouldn't that be a description? Wouldn't that be a physical picture of the spiritual truth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? I believe what God is giving us here is a picture of Jesus Christ. And I pray none of us will become so hard, so cold, so callous, as we see Saul has become in this picture of a Christian that's at the very wrong time. What about those of you who this morning may be in that very place? What about those of you who this morning may be here and you've been hiding in the shell? Maybe there's somebody in here that's been trying to disguise themselves and disguise their actions. Maybe there's somebody in here this morning who's brought others into their sin. If that's you, what can you expect from God? What, as a church, could we tell you to expect from God? This is what I see. I see a picture of a God who will not let his children go. This is a beautiful picture of no matter how far down you've gone, no matter what you have done, God will go to great lengths. God will perform miracles. He will reach down into the miry clay in order to get his children to come back to him. I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you're going. I don't care where you're at. Your Lord loves you, and he will seek you in those places. I mean, I can understand God going after David. He made mistakes. He made great mistakes. But he had a repentant heart. But Saul's given up on God. Why go after him? Because that's how the God we serve is. He loves his children. He calls them out no matter how far they sank. Amazing scene if you think about it. Saul was a big man. The scripture says he stood head and shoulders above all men of Israel, and we see him prostrate on the ground, fear on his face. And this is basically what Samuel says to him. Samuel says to Saul, this child of God, God has departed from you. God has become your adversary, your enemy. The Lord has taken away your kingdom and he's given it to somebody else. You have not obeyed God. You have sinned against the Lord. You and your son have one more day to live. God's offering him a chance of repentance. God forgives our sins if we repent, but there's always a consequence to our sin. Tomorrow, you and your sons will die, and your kingdom will be turned over to the enemy, and then Samuel simply disappears. And this big man laying prostrate on the ground, he hears these words, and he's afraid because of what Samuel has told him, and he just lays there, and he thinks about what Samuel is saying. Let's run through his mind and thinks about it. You sinned against God. Is there anybody in here who's ever sinned against God? Is there anybody in here that God may have taken something away from your kingdom? I don't know about you, but I have, and he has. Has God ever become your enemy? You know, there have been times in my life when I felt like God was my enemy. Now, I know it wasn't true, but I felt like it was. He says, you've rejected God. There have been times when I put my trust in myself and not in my God. If you heard what Samuel said, what would you do? I mean, if it was me, I'd be begging God for forgiveness. I would be begging God to just forgive me for what I've done. I'd be repentant. This is a picture. This is an account of the great revelation of God's love and God's grace and God's mercy. He'll follow his children all the way to the fire. He'll meet his children at the witch's house. He calls to you and he asks you to repent. He'll even use a miracle of the Lord Jesus Christ to get you to come back to him. We started out this by saying there was a picture of both of these Christians were at places they didn't belong. One of them was David. David repented of his sins. He comes back to the Lord. According to the record, the other one doesn't. He leaves with no repentance, no tears, no broken heart. The last picture we get of Saul eating his last meal. This far as record, but this is the last meal Saul ever eats. And he's eating last meal in the witch's house, prepared by the witch. next day he dies in battle, just as Samuel had prophesied, but when he dies, he is still rebellious. He refuses to die by the hand of the uncircumcised. He takes his own life. He commits suicide with his own sword. And the very last time the name of the Lord comes out of his mouth, and the very last recorded meal he eats, is that of what he says? A meal prepared by the Lord. I don't know everything this story tells us, but I know this one. It tells me God never gives up on his children. We see Saul, and we see how low he had become. We see Saul in a witch's house, and we see God coming after him. I may not know everything this story pictures, but I know God doesn't give up on his children. God doesn't give up on us. God loves us with an amazing everlasting grace and love and mercy. God doesn't give up on us while we live, not even if he finds us at a witch's house. He doesn't give up on you, and he doesn't give up on me. Such is the mercy of our God. This is a great revelation of grace. We see God, and we see him following his children all the way to the very bottom. He meets us where we're at, even if we're at the witch's house. He calls us to repentance by the miracle of the Lord Jesus Christ. Folks, I want you to know, if you ever get to a place where you become hardened, where you become cold, where you become rebellious, so much so that you have turned your back on God and you have become an enemy of God, if you wake up and you find yourself in a witch's house, don't you dare think that God has turned his back on you. Don't you think that God doesn't love you. Don't you think that God doesn't want you back. Repent and believe the good news. The kingdom of heaven is near. God is a God of grace. God is a God of mercy. God is a God of love, and he loves you too much to turn away from you. It's never too late for you to come back to God. You've never done so much. God won't take you back. He took David back when he was killing the very people he loved. He took David back when he committed adultery. He took David back when he committed murder. Maybe this morning you find yourself in some wrong places. Maybe you've been seeking something other than God. Maybe you've been listening to things, listening to people, going some places, doing some things. You found yourself in some places you know you shouldn't be in. I just want you to know, God has not given up on you. It's not too late for you to come back to him. It's not too late to make the right choice. Deuteronomy chapter 30, God's word says, I'll call heaven and earth as witnesses against you today, that I've set before you life and death, that you may love the Lord your God, and you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days. Folks, if there's somebody in here that needs to come up to this altar and choose life this morning, I'm going to ask Jimmy to come back up. A closing song, and I'll get you out of here. I plan about 15 minutes long, and I apologize. But if you're in that low place, if you're in that place, or if you're considering being at that low place, just come and seek God, because God is seeking you no matter where you're at, no matter what you've done, no matter what you think you're about to do. If you know somebody that's in a low place, somebody that's at the bottom, if you know somebody, especially somebody who confesses Christ and they're going to places that they shouldn't be going, they're doing some things they shouldn't be doing, they're seeking advice from people they know they shouldn't be seeking advice from, standing in the darkness, disguising themselves, you can come up here and you can stand in the gap for them. Folks, I just, if you don't get anything else out of this morning, if you get nothing else out of this message, please remember, God is a God of grace. God is a God of mercy. And no matter how far you're from, you're a child of God, and he calls to you even in your sin, because he has an everlasting love for you. He has sent his son, Jesus Christ, who died and was resurrected from the dead, to give you another chance. God is love, and God is mercy, and God is grace, and he calls you no matter what you've done or what you're doing. Will you repent? and seek God as he seeks you, like David did, and become the man and woman after God's own heart, or will you reject God and die in your sin? Friends can't, family members can't. God loves you, God seeks you, and God offers his grace, his mercy, and life. Will you stand with me and I sing this closing hymn?